In line with the spirit of this session, I'm going to present a method that can be helpful, I think, for the study of contemporary selection that is acting nowadays, I mean, in real time. It's not a historical approach, but rather a contemporary selection approach. And we will look at how can we investigate the genomic basis of contemporary selective processes. And this is an approach that can be useful for trees because although it's based on temporal data, it's a within generation approach, single generation, and we will focus on specific life stages with data taken from a prospective cohort mortality. And if we are to understand the complex interaction between the environment and adaptive evolution, we have to take into account that, the life cycle can be complex and that selection may be different depending on what stage we are dealing with. And in traditional, in the classical selection component analysis, we separate viability, sexual, fecundity, and gametic selection. And in this talk, we are focusing on viability selection, which is selection affecting survival probability from the zygotic to the adulthood stages. And as you can imagine, in trees, this is a period of the life cycle where there are dramatic changes in ontogeny, and therefore also in selection. And typically, given the long life cycle of trees, we will also have big variation in demography and in micro and macro environmental conditions. So the study questions are, if we can detect loci under contemporary stage specific viability selection in the wild, in field studies, and if we can measure the corresponding selection coefficients, and where the selection coefficient is defined as the relative fitness of the alternative homozygotes. So, genomic scans of selection are widely used, as you all know. Many of them are based on a single temporal sample, and we compare the observed versus the expected pattern of genetic variation under some particular demographic and selective model. In this category, we have, for instance, those based on the frequency spectrum or in FST on FST levels. Among populations or linkage disequilibrium and so on. But these methods measure historical selection, not contemporary selection. Then we have a different category of methods that use multi-generational time series data. And these methods measure also total selection. I mean, even if they could focus on only two generations, which is hard. Normally they need many more generations to be powerful enough. They measure total selection, okay? So what we need is a method that can take advantage of within generation longitudinal cohort mortality studies. And in this case, some methods have been applied and they can measure a contemporary viability selection. But so far, these methods have not attempted to estimate explicitly selection coefficients, but rather only to test the null hypothesis of neutrality. So this is our demographic model. We have a large cohort of unknown and decreasing size. We need mortality to exist, otherwise there is no viability selection. We assume that there are no new individuals joining the cohort after the initial time step, or if there are, we can discriminate them and exclude them from the samples. And we assume that we don't sample exhaustively the cohort, okay? Think of a large cohort of seedlings, for instance, or of fishes or whatever. So we take relatively small random samples at each time step. So, and we will consider as reference genotypic frequencies, those of the zygote pool after gamete fusion, okay? Think, for instance, of the large seed crop before dispersal in a stand. And under the null hypothesis that of neutrality, then each of our temporal samples will be simply a multinomial draw from this large zygote pool of zygotes. So, however, if we have selection, and this is the part in which we are interested, after the initial moment, the first sample. If we have selection, then of course, this sampling is no longer multinomial. We will have to consider the selection and how it affects in a deterministic way genotypic frequencies. Okay, so first let's just start with a neutrality test. So right now we don't focus on the selection coefficients, but rather on having a test that can tell us whether the observed allele frequency changes between two time steps can be explained by stochastic mortality. This is by genotypic independent mortality and by random sampling. So we can define allele frequency change as statistic. And then what we want to know is what is the probability to observe a change in allele frequencies, a temporal change in allele frequencies larger or equal the observed one under the null hypothesis of neutrality. And this probability can be calculated exactly or quasi exactly, simply as the compound multinomial probability of all possible draws of size N1 and N2 that satisfy the above condition. And I say quasi exact because in fact we need to know the allelic frequencies, okay, that we have to estimate from the samples. Okay, so that's our neutrality temporal test. And now if we want to go farther and we want to estimate selection coefficients, we will have to use this fundamental equation of natural selection, that is one of the classical equation in population genetics, where we can express the expected genotypic frequencies after selection as a function of the frequencies before selection and the relative fitness of each genotype. 1-1, it's one homozygote, 1-2 heterozygote, 2-2 the other homozygotes. Okay, this is the relative fitness of the three possible genotypes, frequencies before selection, and this is the relative fitness, or what is the relative survival probabilities. This term here, this average, is the mean fitness of the cohort. Okay, so we use a Bayesian estimation approach, assuming that we have both random sampling plus selection, and we can write the probability of the initial count of genotypes that we observe at time zero as a function of the unknown genotypic probabilities. And then we can also write down the probability of observing genotypic counts at time t as a function of the initial unknown genotypic frequencies and of the unknown selection coefficients in previous time steps. And also if we want to include in the model the dominance coefficient, okay? And then while using, for instance, MCMC approach, we can approximate the posterior joint distribution of the genotypic frequencies, the initial genotypic frequencies, and the selection coefficients at each time step. So we did a simulation analysis of method performance, and we did a lot of different scenarios with about 1,000 independent replications each, considering either absence of selection, weak selection, or strong selection. Different cohort sizes, different sample sizes from 100 to 10,000 individuals, and different minor allele frequencies, okay? And we want to know what is the power of the method when there is no selection, and what is the false positive or type one error rate when there is actually selection, okay? We have here an illustration of model estimates under neutrality, weak, and strong selection with the points, the dots are the median posterior estimates, and the vertical lines are credibility intervals. So as for the results of the neutrality test, assuming there is no selection, okay, we want to know what is the false positive rate. And the method, the neutrality test, works quite well, because the false positive rate is about the same as the nominal value of 5%. And this is independent of the sample size and the minor allele frequency. So if there is selection, and in this case, we are looking at a strong selection, what is the power of the method? What is the probability of considering a loci under selection when it actually is under strong selection? In here in the top, you have, just for reference, an exhaustive sampling scenario where we sample the entire cohort. So that's why we have almost 100% of power. And this other, we have decreasing sample sizes. And as you can see, the power is moderate to low, and it increases with the sample size and with a minor allele frequency. So, and we have in general low power or very low power when the locus is close to fixation. And this is independent of the sample size. If we have weak selections, things get much worse. So the test most often fail to reject the null hypothesis of neutrality. And what is worse, the power is of the same order as the false positive rate under neutrality. Okay, now we are looking here at the errors in the estimation of the selection coefficients themselves. Here is the bias, root mean square error, and the credibility interval non-coverage rate, okay? These are different sample sizes from the smallest to the largest and different minor allele frequencies. And what you can see here is that the bias and the root mean square error both rapidly decrease as the sample size increases. However, the root mean square error is only lower than the value of the selection coefficient itself when either we have a large sample and a minor allele frequency larger than 0.1 or a relatively smaller sample for minor allele frequencies larger than 0.3. And again, good news, the credibility interval, actual coverage is close to nominal values in all cases. In the case of weak selection, as we saw previously for the neutrality test, the estimation of the selection coefficients gets virtually impossible. So the relative root mean square error, it's in the order of 10 times larger than the value of the selection coefficient itself. So really there is no hope in estimating the selection coefficient under weak selection. The good news is that the uncertainty estimates remain accurate. Okay, and as an experimental case study, as I'm going to present one that we did on an isolated marginal population of Pinus pinaster in Fuencaliente in Spain, where we can find about 300 individuals in a 10 hectares area in a very marginal ecosystem with a strong, very strong early mortality. So this was a pilot study. The sample sizes were not large, even if we sampled almost exhaustively all the seedlings that we could found in the site. But we only achieved a first initial sample of about 100 individuals. So we collected immediately after the onset of seedling emergence in the field. Then about 100 individual seedlings more in late winter. And finally, we could only find about 45 seedlings remaining in July next year. And we use an assay of 384 candidate gene SNPs, of which about 300 were polymorphic and 237 had minor allele frequencies larger than 5%. And what you can see here is the distribution of temporal allele frequency changes for two separate periods. The first one, winter period after seedling emergence, and the later spring to summer period, okay? And what we found is that there was no significant evidence of genotype-dependent mortality during the second study period, in gray, most likely due to the small sample size. The last of the samples was really small. But we found 5 loci that exhibited temporal allele frequency changes that were significantly larger than expected from random mortality and sampling alone. These 5 loci were related, not surprisingly, with some functions, since they were, we use candidate genes, But interestingly, they were related mostly with seedling fitness traits associated with water stress and other abiotic stress responses and with some basic cellular signaling function. So, and if you look at the median estimates of the selection coefficients, you can see that they are, the absolute values are quite large and significantly different from zero. Okay, as conclusions, it is feasible to discriminate loci under strong selection with moderate or even with high confidence by increasing the sample size as long as the locus is not close to fixation. The estimates of the selection coefficients are minimally biased for strongly selected loci, but large samples are necessary to reduce the relative root mean square error below 100%. So under weak selection, allele frequency changes are largely driven by sampling noise, so there is really not much that we can infer here. And the good news is that the methods do not tend to mistake neutral loci as being under selection more frequently than expected. Okay, and with this, I finish my presentation and I will be happy to take questions if there are any.